As I often say, I shut it on iPhone by default, right? I was first thinking of, you know, having a beautiful camera, setup, production, and all of that. And nobody was willing to come with me on my, you know, trip. And so instead of going depressed or, you know, I looked in my pocket and I had an iPhone and I was like, what can we do with this? And from that point on, I got like more and more excited by what the iPhone had to offer. So we shot the film 5 years ago, and we shot it with the four and the 4S. So there was no, you know, today that you have like all the lenses and all of that. But we did it with really a raw iPhone, and it became really like interesting, and I was passionate about finding the language of that machine. And it became a part of the story and the process. I was really amazed and in the same time by the limitation and by the possibilities of it. And that's how, you know, we went on with this, and we shot, I don't know, 20 hours of, you know, rushes, and I came back. I wasn't sure that I had a film. I was like, well, okay, that's cool, but... And then we watched the images with my editor, Jean-Marie Langelet, who is an amazing editor. And I asked him, do you think we can do something with iPhone images? Is it going to be possible to work with them, you know, to screen them and everything? And so we looked and we found out that we could process them and solidify them. And yes, there was a film. And so that's how it came about.
There's a lot of red. It's in the image of Saul running on the side of the highway. It's the fonts. The color of the major kind of like font for the promotionals. What's the kind of, and some of the strongest visuals are highlighted with red and colors on the spectrum. What are the ways that you colored the film, the ways that you were very deliberate about evoking different kinds of emotion kind of through the relationship deteriorating, through the kind of formation of a new relationship, kind of, what was your, just your relationship with color through this process and, you know, Saul as well?
Well, again, it was all, because it, those are iPhone images, when we got the editing, I was like, why not, you know, go really far with it and see what we can do. Everybody can color grade their images today, on Instagram, whatever you can choose, you know, your filters and everything. And I was, you know, willing to explore that possibility. And I shot with black and white HD and 8mm filters, and so I already knew that when you do something in black and white, for instance, automatically you think that it's past. When you do something that is very saturated, you are possibly in a dream. Colors have in themselves like possibilities of evoking and telling also a story. And so I wanted to, you know, to see how we could get some emotions, where the emotion would be the most powerful. And so that's why in color grading we pushed it. We really pushed it because also of the story and the dream-like universe that I want to be sensitive, you know, sensible. I wanted to give the you know, that what happens in the dreams is that you can go from black and white to color. You can go from monochromes to, you know, spaces that are incoherent and incoherent after the other. And so I wanted to see if I could, and so why and how we got there.
And then on the note of the title Dreamstates, why did you call it Dreamstates? And what were you trying to do in making blurry the boundaries between kind of the dream life, the dream state, and the material state, the corporal state? And what does love look like in all of that?
I think you answered the question. it's called dream states because it is what it is. I thought it was very much the title came quickly, right? It was like always dream states and we were crossing 32 states and we were telling that story of, you know, of the blurring lines between reality and dreams. And I thought that also America was the perfect setup for that kind of questions and that kind of stories because of the American dream and how love can survive in that American dream or not. How or not.
Can black love survive the American dream?
Well.
How much time do you have?
We filmed with music, which I think is quite, it gives something to the film because when you film in music, I think it changes the movement of your camera, it changes the way you are filming, the rhythm and stuff like that. So that's one part. And then they worked with Nikkei on the score.
Right, so in terms of the score, It's exactly as Anisia said. I was given the directive of her wanting to capture sort of sketches of the beginnings of ideas. And in my relationship to touring is usually a very productive time. Like you can squander the energy and, you know, party, blah, 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 blah. You can celebrate the energy in that way as well. You can also take that energy and like, I remember like 2003, I had the honor of touring with the band, the Mars Volta, and who had like gone from like being crackheads to being like straight edge. And so what I loved about the tour was that the shows would be amazing. And then the energy of the shows we'd take into the hotel room and like vomit. And record and play around with ideas and take what was happening on stage, like, you know, and so that's something that I was doing beforehand, but after that I was encouraged to do even more, to always, you know, I did the same thing. I was working with Trent Reznor, was always like taking the energy of the show, someone who had at once used to party after concerts and then was like, no, I'm gonna stay away from that. So taking all that energy and like bringing the equipment into hotel rooms and saying, let's just keep on pounding, because you can't necessarily control, you know, you can start it up, but when the show is over, you may not be over, you know? And so I related very much to what Anisia was asking of me. Pretty much just kept on sharing ideas as they came, and she incorporated them into her editing process.
Yeah. And also, in terms of sound, I something interesting about the iPhone sound. So we were doing the air with our sound engineer. And we had to redo some voices, right? And he was like, let's record it on iPhone because it has a special quality also. And I found it very, since then, people have recorded albums on iPhones, on all those machines, but I think there's something there also.
Yeah, and it shouldn't go without noting that her sound engineer, like the editor, the sound engineer, Blakely, and the editor, Jean-Marie Langier, both are fascinating characters, masters of their craft, and really had a lot of fun participating in the process and brought a lot to it as well.
So all of the scenes were, like, all of it is active in the stage. I thought some of it was, like, documentary, like, because like, it's the iPhone, are y'all video on the floor, or the whole sort of stage? So, like, all of it was
active. The only thing, just the stage was.
Now, the stage performances are stage performances, but they are stage performances with me in the middle of them, right? Okay. Going on stage and filming them like this. So it's already kind of something, you know?
Yeah.
That is, it is really the story is scripted, but I was very much open to with it in reality. In fact, I was provoking reality because I think also because of those cameras. I think that's what get me passionate about it, is that it changes the relationship to being filmed. And so when you tell people, can you please redo this, I'm filming you, they're like, yeah, okay, whatever, you know. I was just there with my girl, thing like that, and so they were like, okay, I'm gonna redo it, but really,
yeah.
Come on, what are you doing? You
know? So the tour was real.
Yeah.
The tour was real.
Okay, and then the story was deep intimate.
And also, I mean, well, there's a lot of moments where it's like, where I know, where she's like, go, blah, 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 do this, da, 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 da. And the people in the room may not know, but I know. And then if something happens, then she might come in and say, actually, I need you guys to do what you did again, and I need you to do what you did again. And, then, and so then, yeah, so it depends, but yeah.
So my question is framed by the frame of this screening, the black aesthetic. Something that I saw repeating in the imagery was the patterns of the built environment. The American built environment, the environment on the road trip. And I'm just curious to hear what you have to say, if anything, about how the black aesthetic or a black aesthetic interpreted the life on the road. This is like a lead in to like an international perspective on America, but also just the beauty of the geometric images that you presented and the repetition and go from there.
You went far. I mean, I can leave it there. I mean, yeah. It's funny. I was, you know, we drove here, and I was like, it is also very much my first impression of America. Okay, it was intentionally, yes.
No, I'm just laughing because I remember when we went to Dallas, you were like, Dallas?
Yes. Dallas, Texas, all of the, I mean, a lot of things are not, a lot of things are not in the film because they could, I mean, couldn't be make the cut and the story, but it's true that I was also very present to whatever was, you know, new to me, and I think it gave the mood, right? Whatever I captured on that trip was really like. To me, the geometry and all the emptiness and the sensation that I was feeling, it's what I really wanted to share. I really wanted to be a part of what would be the story and the film, and. I found that it was interesting to have the luck to have such a setup, because if I had to make that film in film production, you know, normal production situations, I think it's a film that would cost like millions, you know, to have all that spectrum. And I think to talk about America and the American dream, it was an amazing opportunity to be able to really give that dimension, to feel the characters lost in that architecture, you know. How it infiltrates you. How you are like crossing landscapes that are making you think about First Nation, you know, and their absence, and in the same time you are discovering these weak people that are, you know, moving through that, and what does, you know, how does it feel? What does it give? What kind of fiction is that? So that's, I don't know if I answered your question, but I understood a lot of things through framing that, through how I could pull emotions from that. It's also for me the realization that this country is so big, so big. And as a foreigner, it explains a lot of things. You know, the way America is for the outside very much centered on itself, you know, and enclosed. And it was always a mystery for me, like, what? Why? They have everything, to know everything, you know, everything. How comes that it's so enclosed, right? In a way. And I understood something of that when I was traveling through all those states. I was like, okay, it's so big that you can forget about everybody else, mm-hmm. right? So things like that.
Where are you from?
I'm from Rwanda.
I think we maybe have time for like one more question.
Wait, I want to say something. I want to say that I'm so happy to be here tonight with Zoe. Yeah. And I have to say that a full flower is in the crowd, and she works with us on the film. And then Marie, as she said, is just right there. So I'm just saying this because these women are with me.
Clap, people, please.
So yeah, I met Zoe and Maria right before we got into the LA Film Festival, and they came on board, and like, I don't know, they were amazing, and it's a real pleasure, and I'm very grateful to be here with them tonight. And then Ifuru came on board and is working with us, flourishing film. She has an amazing catalog and taste for films, and we are very happy to be with her, and so we are happy that she made it here. And Furu, where are you? Come over. Maybe people want to ask you some questions.
I think we maybe have time for one.
Yes, one question. If flowers, come on. If you want to talk.
Yeah. I don't know.
Okay. Whatever you want to talk about.
Yeah, so Flourishing Films is a company that I founded in 2016. I represent black movies from around the world for sale. Yeah. that's what I do. That's what I'm doing with Dreamstates. I think I contacted you guys on Facebook. It was like, hey, what are you guys doing with this film? I'd love to talk to you about it. So that was in 2016 at the LA Film Festival. And one of the things that Anisia said to me was that she wanted to do this theatrical release of her film. And, you know, usually distributors aren't looking to do a theatrical release on a film such as Dreamstates. They're looking for, you know, narratives that have well-known people. Saul is a well-known person, but, I mean, they're not looking to do smaller sort of films in this fashion. And so I said, sure, I'll take that on. Let's see what we can do. And so we've done this tour around the world, and so we're really excited that we brought it here and that it's been a success everywhere it's been. So
where are we next?
Next we're in LA.
Yes.
Yep. Yeah. It's Zebulon in LA, yeah. So that should be really fun. November 5th, we're gonna have some performances as well as the screening. So Saul will be there and we'll have some special guests, so that should be fun.
One more question.
Go ahead.
Just how you said you began the film 5 years ago, how has your relationship changed over these years, and how does intimacy play into that?
Tell us. No comment. No, I don't have any. I mean, it's really like, okay, Saul and I, we are both actors, right? So it's really for us very clear that it's a fiction. And so this is not about our relationship. It's about a relationship.
And it's not the first film that we did together.
No, it's not. And we played husband and wife.
Yeah.
In another film. So it's a love story, a fiction, a story that is not ours, obviously. Right?
And last question, Ra.
Okay, thank y'all. I guess my question is about the sequencing of the kind of like the voiceover we hear of the mother talking about Trayvon Martin and talking about kind of like this crisis about like black masculinity in America and the vulnerability of her son, and the choice for that to be followed by the breakup, or what I'm reading at least is the breakup, and wanting to hear a little bit about kind of that moment and that the kind of rage that seems to follow it, and like what was the thinking behind that.
Yeah, you know, it's a great, I think it's a good question, because it's exactly what it is about. It's why I was saying it's also a story that questions the possibility of love in this environment, and we are in a story with specific people, and to talk about reality, that woman was really talking on the radio when I was filming. Mm-hmm. And so I had a scene of crisis that I wanted to do, that we shot in New Orleans, and then this happened, and this was exactly what it was about. Yeah. So it became the crisis in a real and in the fiction. And so we were really touring at that moment, at that precise moment, and we were really our body were informed by those things while being in the in those landscape. So yeah, it's it's absolutely what I what we want to tell. Yeah.
Yeah. It's really a kind of a surreal thing. For me as well, because I was living in Paris at the time and we did that tour. And the most beautiful thing, aside from the fact that it was like double work, like touring and when off stage, like acting, blah, 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 was I was getting to experience America vicariously through Anisia. And so traveling to many places perhaps I'd been before, but seeing them with fresh eyes, and she'd be there like, whoa, why are there so many flags? Look at all those crosses. What the fuck? Like I mentioned Dallas earlier, and they'd be like, whoa, they really are wearing those boots. Whoa. Oh my God. RoboCop. Was it RoboCop?
Yeah. We shot.
Yeah, yeah, that's right, in a building where they shot part of RoboCop, and she recognized, she was like, this is in RoboCop! Like, how do you know that? at Sons of Herman, right, in Dallas, and then Trayvon Martin happened, right? And so, yes, that moment on the radio was real, and Anisia was traveling with a number of African-American men, particularly through America, and the concerts were one thing, but the rest stops and the gas stations and all that was another, and she was, you know, also observing our behavior, like, no, let's not stop there. There was so, I mean, like, I remember we stopped at a place in Iowa that had all these, like, pro-life sort of like signs all over the gas station, and then on the register it said that you could get a 10% discount on gas if you're wearing a cross. And so every time she just look at me and be like, you can do that?
Yeah.
Like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, and so and so, you know, there were so many layers, and so that moment in particular was very strong, but so were many others, particularly because we were all kind of, you know, openly dealing with and contemplating the reality, our reality moving through this country with Anisia there to you know, bounce ideas and all this stuff. And so, yes, it's I love your question because it's on point, and I think it has everything to do with that that chaos of that moment and the relationship and the whole nine and it's a real moment where reality encroached on the story, and so what's crazy is that by the time you get to shooting in New York, you know, it's you hear those chants in the background because that's what it's become at that moment. And what I love about that moment is that it's not necessarily the story, but it is not to be erased from the story.
All right, well, thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Anisia. Thank you, Dreamstates. Thank you, Saul. Thank you, Drew. Get home safe, y'all.